adaptive capacity. But the big thing is how to reconcile flexibility on the one hand and certainty on the other hand, especially given the different time scales and given the difference between the economic time scale and the climate time scale. And maybe this is the most important finding. The change globally from public to private sectors means we have to re-educate all governance universities. They still mainly think in government governance. And we'll have to learn from each other worldwide. Decision support. There are many large research projects that already offer an integrated approach. So scientists are working on this integrated approach for the policymakers. There's not even so much methodological innovation. They are techniques we have already. But reconciling, indeed, the socioeconomic uncertainty with climate uncertainty is the major challenge. And finally, imaging, you know, show an image of impacts, but also of future possibilities will help to gain interest and participation. Health issues still neglected. We should pay more attention. And through climate change research, we see that health issues, water, air, and urban quality, they are all related. Extremes, and this is a very hot topic, you know. Were these floods in Pakistan caused by climate change? Well, we cannot say. But insurers see a clear increasing trend in measured disaster losses. And we all tend to believe that this could be climate change. But scientists clearly tell us, and statistical analysis shows that they are mainly can be attributed to an increase in wells and exposure. We do expect the climate signal will pick up and become visible, but it's not yet possible to prove scientifically that climate change is in the signal of increasing damage. It's mainly increase in wells and exposure. Low perception of extreme events by communities and policymakers has led to major underinvestment in the prevention and damage reduction measures. So many places in the world, including New York and Manhattan, are much more vulnerable than is economically viable. Innovative schemes in insurance may help guide development and through that reduce vulnerability. Then I want to show some of the deltas we discussed. The Mekong. Well, the government of Vietnam is working on adaptation with military planning. Awareness goals, 56% of the population should be aware of climate and adaptation, and 100% of the civil servants is their goal. Well, I'll move on to Indonesia. These lowlands, these rural deltas, they're particularly vulnerable, but the government of Indonesia has given these areas to private sector and licensed. They've been licensed by the government and difficult to control now. It's vulnerable peatland, but there are opportunities in the forestry sector for compensation, financial compensation for not cutting trees. And there are important challenges for understanding the biophysical system of peatlands. Livelihoods should be more explicit and not just lip service in major plans. This is Bangladesh. The red line indicates the 1 meter sea level rise contour. These are the issues. It's not just sea level. It's, of course, cyclone, saline water, etc. People are adapting to floods already and salination in Bangladesh. It's their way of life. We could learn from them how to adapt. What was new to me, and I guess to you, many of you, is that salination, this salter water, has a negative influence on prenatal child development in this area. But the good news is Bangladesh has a comprehensive climate adaptation plan, and it has initial national funds to start implementation. Of course, attracting funds from abroad as well, but Bangladesh has taken the lead with their own funds, an example in the third world. The Nile. Creating awareness among population and politics is the major challenge according to the Egyptian representatives here. Freshwater scarcity, as we know, in the Nile area is the most important, but coastal inundation is coming up next with this big flat delta. Demographic development, urban development, food production, They're all difficult to accommodate and manage. But in Egypt, they have a major drainage rehabilitation system underway. Still, the opportunities to take climate adaptation on board still must be reaped. The Po Delta and Venice, many of you know it. Wetlands in the Po Delta are most vulnerable. Venice is technically well protected with its storm surge barrier. It will be ready in 2 years. It's worthwhile to see. But institutional arrangement, according to our scientists from this region, institutional arrangements are by far the bottleneck. They have not agreed yet who's in charge of this barrier, when to close it or open it. Well, that is difficult, you know, we all know. Is it the water boards? Is it the city? Is it the region? Is it, well, whoever. Is it the private sector? The harbor in Venice has offered to take control. The Rhine Delta. Dealing with uncertainty in climate scenarios in relation to investment decisions is a major issue there. So we have a developed delta where this uncertainty and investment comes directly together. And adaptive management, we all preach it, but you know, not everyone likes it because investors want clarity for the years to come. California, well, these are their messages. They are there to stay. That's what they say. Did you know that energy, 19% of the electric energy in California is used to pump water? I wasn't aware of this. 19%, it's incredible. I mean, the Netherlands, which all is our pumping stations, we have far less. It's less than 1%, I believe. Then the Elbe, Cuxhaven. In the Elbe, well, actually, man-made effects are dominant over climate effects for the time being. Financing adaptation, we've had a good report, but you should be aware there is still a major international debate going on. Will it in the end cost 100 billion or 1,000 billion euro per year? And there are now private sector initiatives to build funds, equity funds, and we heard in that meeting. The role of cities, well, as was said to us, cities need to act now. They cannot and will not wait for national governments to develop policies and measures. And cities are politically aware. They want a formalized position in the international allocation of funds. There the challenge is the private sector to bring them on board, etc. Finally, the builders community. Well, we just had a beautiful presentation. And indeed, is the market the bottleneck? Is it the skills? Or is it the capacity to deliver all this mitigation and adaptation efforts? And they call on governments to help with experimental areas and pilot projects free of existing rules and regulations. And there have some been here, some in Rotterdam. And this is my final sheet, the Delta Alliance. I was so happy to see that all deltas, and there are over 12, that joined forces to create this international community. It's a timely vehicle, it looks, to further develop and reinforce our international community towards climate-proofing of deltas. And a major product of the Delta Alliance coming up is this comparative assessment of vulnerability and resilience of deltas, including a scorecard and the index. And we would like to develop it together with you, with all deltas, and in the framework of the Delta Alliance over the months to come. And well, most fortunate, we will meet again. The governor of Jakarta and his representatives have announced to have a future Delta Alliance meeting. They call it a Delta Summit in Jakarta next year, October, where, of course, special attention will be given to Southeast Asia. And I hope we will all be there. Ladies and gentlemen, I really want to thank you for your so active participation in our joint effort. And I'm looking forward to continue our work together. Thank you.
Thank you, Pierre Wellinga, for taking us and giving us such a thorough and complete